Thank you. We're now moving back into session, and therefore I would ask any members in the public gallery who are leaving at the moment to please do so quietly, as we are now going back into our formal business. And thank you very much for your cooperation. It is much appreciated. The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 11282 in the name of Mark Ruscoe on restoring nature to tackle climate change. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Mark Ruscoe around 7 minutes, please, to open the debate.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I thank members for signing the motion, and to those joining me this lunchtime, to shine a light on the twin nature and climate crises and how communities across Scotland are responding. And my Green colleagues recognise the critical role of nature restoration in the fight against climate change, and that's why we prioritise the Nature Restoration Fund through the Bute House Agreement. And the NRF will now deliver £65 million of funding for projects on land and at sea over the 5 years of this Parliament. So far, £30 million has been granted to more than 150 projects across Scotland. Now, today, as I've just highlighted in FMQs, it's the start of COP28, but it's also 1 year on from the signing of the UN Biodiversity Framework and the adoption of the critical target to require a third of our degraded habitats across the globe to be restored by 2050. The Dubai COP will discuss how to harness finance for this work on its Nature Day on the 9th of December, with the aim of mobilising $200 billion per year for biodiversity by 2030. Now, the Nature Restoration Fund has allowed us to take the first steps towards that goal here in Scotland, and I'm proud that the fund, launched on the same Nature Day at the Glasgow COP 2 years ago, has been so successful. Countries around the world will be following Scotland's footsteps to support on-the-ground action that is so vital for achieving the aims of the global biodiversity framework. However, I think it's important to remind ourselves again that Scotland sadly remains a nature-depleted country. This year's State of Nature report underlines that our wildlife has decreased on average by 15% since the 90s. 1 in 9 Scottish species are still threatened with extinction. Nearly half of seabirds have declined since the 80s, as have nearly half of our flowering plants. Nature is impacted not only by exploitation of our land and seas, but increasingly by climate change. We only have to look at our wild salmon populations, for example, to recognise how warming temperatures affect their delicate ecology. But through restoration projects that help nature to adapt and become more resilient to climate change, while locking up carbon and helping us to adapt to flooding and extreme weather, we can tackle these twin crises together. And these nature-based solutions, as they're often called, are rarely quick wins. It does take time to build up the action needed at scale that can make the difference. And nature, of course, needs decades to fully build back. But scientists do believe that these projects to restore and expand nature will be critical for cooling global temperatures over the long term, beyond the net zero goals that have been set for the middle of the century. And they could play an important role to bring us back down from peak global warming, but only if we start acting now with an eye on the future for our children's children. Now, this year's State of Nature report said, and I'll quote, "The social and ecological consequences of living in a nature-depleted country are immense. They include impacts on human health, happiness and well-being, alongside direct costs associated with lost and damaged ecosystem services." In essence, Presiding Officer, what harms nature also harms us. But that also means that if we restore nature, we also restore all of those lost benefits to ourselves and to our communities. Now, 96% of Scots think that the natural environment is important to the country, so it's no surprise that where we see nature restoration projects take root, they draw in volunteers and whole communities in a shared endeavour. So what's happening around Scotland right now? Well, I'm looking forward to hearing from members about projects across their own areas later in this debate, but what's clear is that we're seeing an amazing range of approaches across the 150 projects that have so far benefited from the fund. From ancient Atlantic rainforests in Argyll to amphibian ponds on former coal mines in Lanarkshire, from pollinator corridors and arable farms to rewilded former airfields in Crail, from coastal dune restoration in St Andrews to seagrass and oyster bed reseeding in the Forth, communities, NGOs, landowners big and small are working out how to restore neglected spaces, neglected neglected species and landscapes. And I want to highlight some of this work that is happening in my own region, and particularly in the freshwater environment, because our rivers, burns, lochs, floodplains and wetlands are the arteries and organs of our catchments. From source to estuary, they sustain incredible species and habitats, but they also supply us with water when we need it while buffering us from floods. And the relationship between watercourses and our land is critical because over many years, we have degraded land to the point where water freely thunders off hillsides into swollen rivers. Rivers that had often been canalised and moulded by industry over the centuries with barriers that impact species like the salmon. So I really welcome the NRF-funded work that Forth Rivers Trust have done on the Allan Water, placing large woody structures to create wetlands, reconnecting floodplains and planting riparian trees. Working with the community at Pool of Muckett in Clackmannanshire, they've also built wetlands, installed overflow channels and introduced leaky dams to mitigate flood risks. While on the River Teith, they pushed on with establishing riparian woodlands, planting over 10,000 trees along the banks with the community, and the restoration of 20 hectares of wetland at Blair Creek. Now, Jonathan Louis from Forth Rivers Trust told me that the Nature Restoration Fund has allowed them to collaborate with partners and make a tangible impact on wildlife and communities throughout the Forth region. And further down the Teith catchment at Argatee Farm, they're also using the fund to reconnect their waterways, fencing off areas from cattle, encouraging wildflower seeding, and planting 16,000 trees while establishing new hedgerow corridors. Tom Bowser at Argatee tells me how this will benefit a wide range of species, from pollinators to birds, bats and beavers. He also said how this would simply not have been possible without the fund. And we're seeing very similar work on other catchments, including on the Banff Estate near Aylith, where projects to establish habitats have now been expanded to include another 10
Mr. Roscoe, I appreciate there's a bit
land.
Of latitude here, but I think you'll need to bring your marks to
thank you. So, Presiding Officer, the momentum is building for nature restoration. We are seeing action in Scottish communities as the world gathers to discuss a global response to the climate nature crises. This is just the beginning, but the fund is already creating a legacy for future generations, and I really look forward to seeing progress on the ground in the years to come. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Roscoe. I now call Audrey Nicol to be followed by Stephen Kerr. Ms. Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And first of all, can I apologise to the Chamber? I will have to leave after my contribution due to a pre-existing commitment. So can I thank Mark Ruskell for bringing forward this motion on restoring nature to tackle climate change. It provides us with an important opportunity to recognise the importance and success of the Nature Restoration Fund. It's incredible to think that the fund has already supported 150 projects across Scotland, working to protect watercourses, restore coastal habitats and so much more. And I thank organisations who submitted briefings for today's debate, and I acknowledge in particular the Royal College of Physicians that calls for the climate and nature crises to be recognised as one global health emergency. And I look forward to reading the editorial referenced in the briefing, and I hope that we can return to consider this at a future date. So, like many colleagues, I am in my peaceful space in the outdoors. In a single walk, I have encountered deer, hare, foxes, herons, woodpeckers, raptors, and even red kites. But truth be told, my love and respect of nature has probably been a little bit one way, and more about what I was getting out of nature rather than the other way round. And that was until I became nature champion for the freshwater pearl mussel, and it is through this role that I now better appreciate the importance of projects such as those referred to in the motion, and today I want to highlight another project, the Beltie Burn, a successful nature restoration project in the North East that I was pleased to visit this summer. Now, this project was funded through the Biodiversity Challenge Fund, which I understand, and I stand to be corrected, was a precursor to the Nature Restoration Fund, but nonetheless, thank you, Minister, but nonetheless is, sorry, funded through the Biodiversity Challenge Fund, the Dee Catchment Partnership, the Dee District Salmon Fishery Board and the James Hutton Institute worked tirelessly to re-meander a 1.5-kilometre section of River Channel and reconnect it to four wetland ponds previously straightened to accommodate the Deeside Railway. Wetlands are an incredibly rich food larder for fish, a vitally important aspect of the river habitat. And what has now been created is an improved habitat for fish and other wildlife, whilst also allowing the river to expand and contract during periods of high water. And this was all done at relatively modest cost. So just weeks after work completed in 2020, 15 spawning reds created by salmon and sea trout were seen. And I pay tribute to, in particular, Susan Cooksley and Edwin Third and all the other stakeholders for their utter commitment to this project and for their vision that Belty Burn must not just be a demonstration site, but an example of what we need to do more of across Scotland. So, Presiding Officer, in their briefing, Scottish Environment Link recognise the importance of the Nature Restoration Fund in tackling biodiversity loss, but they also highlight the impact of funding cuts to Scotland's environmental agencies. The fiscal landscape is immensely challenging, but I hope the Scottish Government is able to protect funding for these agencies, especially in light of the expertise and experience that they will potentially contribute.
Mark Ruscoe.
Can I thank the member for giving way? I was wondering, you know, obviously we do have an incredibly challenging fiscal deal coming from the Westminster Government, doesn't keep pace with inflation, but I'm just wondering if she would also reflect on the fact that because of Brexit, because we've lost all that European funding now, including life funding, then carrying out these nature restoration projects is even more challenging now because we don't have that support, that fiscal support from the European Union that was so critical. The Scottish Government's had to step up in order to make these things happen.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the member and I completely agree with the point that he made, and in fact this was something that we reflected on when I visited this particular project and also the site of some pearl mussel survey work that is going on the River Dee. So it's a very strong point, well made. So to conclude, I hope that nature does indeed feature as a key theme in the forthcoming UN Climate Change Conference in Dubai, and that the conference will indeed provide a platform for governments, NGOs and others to demonstrate strong leadership and genuine commitment in tackling the twin nature and climate crisis, so that Scotland can indeed contribute to support projects like the Belty Burn, reduce emissions, reverse nature loss and meet our ambitious climate change targets. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Nicholl. I call Stephen Kerr to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury. Mr Kerr.
Well, Presiding Officer, there's not going to be a lot of disagreement in the Chamber about the value of our natural endowment in Scotland. And certainly, as a Scottish Conservative, I believe in conserving and indeed restoring nature. And I also recognise and agree that there is a correlation between our happiness and our mental health and the environment in which we're living, especially the natural environment. And therefore, I think there's a lot of common ground. So it's very disappointing, but not surprising, to hear Mark Ruskell's last intervention and Audrey Nicholl, where somehow or other we managed to get Brexit into this and another go at the UK government. But it's worth saying that this Scottish government, this SNP Scottish Green government, is doing an appalling job at delivering against its own ambitious plans in terms of Scotland's nature. And I think the problem we've got in Scotland, frankly, is that a lot of good things do happen, but they get lost because of the emphasis, particularly from the Scottish Greens, around more controversial aspects of nature restoration. And I wish to specifically mention rewilding, because while absolutely we should be focused on nature restoration, it is important that we bring people along with us in respect to this very important aspect of the stewardship responsibilities we have for Scotland's natural endowment. But rewilding, I'm afraid, is problematic, because what we are effectively seeing happen before our very eyes in Scotland is a new wave of clearances, where vast tracts of our countryside, where people have been living, are being vacated because there is no space for people with rewilding. Yes, of course.
Mark Ruskell.
Point. I mean, it's very disappointing to hear Mr. Kerr invoke the clearances. Is he honestly saying that rewilding projects that are brought forward by communities, many of whom have applied successfully to Nature Restoration Fund, should be stopped? Is that what he is saying? That he doesn't support communities doing the rewilding, doing this work?
Stephen Kerr.
I'm against faceless organisations, usually with headquarters outside of this country, that are buying up tracts of land and then basically neglecting it. And in the course of doing so, you see clearances. You see people being taken out of those areas of our country. Because if you have rewilding on the scale that is happening in many parts of our country, what you have is you basically see jobs going, communities going, all the social infrastructure going. It is a reckless piece of environmental vandalism. And there, of course I will.
John Swinney.
I'm grateful to Mr. Kerr for giving me. I wonder if he could name an example of an area he's concerned about.
Stephen Kerr.
Well, there are many areas that I'm concerned about, and I'm sure I can more than happy talk to John Swinney subsequent to this debate about areas of interest that we may share as mutual interest. But can I just say that it's important that we listen to Scotland's farmers? That's the point I wish to make in my speech. I wish us to acknowledge that there are genuine concerns that are held by Scotland's farmers. There was a recent meeting between the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and a group of farmers sponsored by NFUS, where one farmer was greeted with applause when he highlighted the fact that there were grave concerns about the nature of rewilding as it impacted their businesses. The quote that I have here from the article that I'm referring to from the Courier last Saturday is that a farmer called Andrew Steele said, "Species such as golden eagles and beavers were all eradicated for a reason, because they are vermin to farmers." In my opinion, the white elephant in the room today is that the SNP went into coalition with the Green Party to run the country. And how can you actually run the country with statements? I will, if I have time, I think.
Briefly,
this will
please,
be the last time.
Well, I appreciate the members being generous with his time, but will he also reflect on the fact that there are farmers who have applied to the Nature Restoration Fund for species reintroduction, for riparian planting, because it benefits their farms and it benefits the local community? Will he acknowledge that there are farmers who support this agenda and are actually financially benefiting from it?
Look, if Mark Ruskell were to listen rather than think about how he can next make an intervention, you'd hear me say that I generally support nature restoration, but I'm raising genuine concerns that are being raised by Scotland's farmers, and they deserve to be listened to, and they deserve to be listened to, and they also need to be worked with. You cannot work against the grain of opinion. And I specifically want to mention the issue surrounding beavers, because that's also been highlighted by the by NFUS, particularly in relation to the recent flooding. Martin Kennedy had something to say about that. Let me just conclude with this quote, if I might, Deputy Presiding Officer. "We need the Scottish Government and Nature Scotland to recognise that in some instances the scale of damage, that's flood damage, was exacerbated by growing beaver activity, burrowing into and significantly weakening long-established flood banks." Now, there's a whole bunch more that I could quote from. But the point is, we need to work with those who are currently the stewards of the land. We need to trust them and work with them and not against them, as they currently feel threatened by the agenda of the Bute House Agreement.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. I now call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Maggie Chapman. Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Nature can be used as a first line of defence against the impacts of the global climate crisis. But we cannot just look at protecting the existing nature and species that we have. We must also make targeted moves towards restoring what has been lost. This means ensuring green spaces in urban areas. It means investing in our rural lands and nature reserves. And it means taking an integrated, targeted and cross-portfolio approaches. Scottish peatlands hold unique carbon-catching properties. In its 2023-2024 programme for government. The Scottish Government made a commitment to restore 10,700 hectares of degraded peatlands over the course of the next year. I welcome this investment in nature and climate restoration and hope to see the targets achieved this year. We need to focus on this just as much as prevention in the fight against climate change. Presiding Officer, the climate and nature emergencies are deeply connected and must be tackled together. We are at a crucial turning point for nature restoration in Scotland. Investment in nature and our natural spaces is vital to reduce biodiversity decline. Scotland's native species inspire and sustain our health and culture. However, Presiding Officer, currently in Scotland, 1 in 9 wildlife species are at risk of extinction. We need to evaluate and abundance and distribution of species in our natural spaces and monitor the extinction risk to ensure we are taking the right course of preventative action. We must also monitor the extent and quality of habitats for these species are up to standard. Targets for nature restoration must drive ambitious action across Scotland, across multiple levels and portfolios, similar to the successful mainstreaming of climate change targets. However, finally, Presiding Officer, we must pair this great investment in Scottish nature with efforts to tackling climate change across the globe. A recent report on climate inequality by Oxfam outlined that the richest 1% of humanity are responsible for more carbon emission than the poorest 66%. This week, I returned from a CPG visit to Bangladesh. There we can see firsthand the impact that climate inequality is having in the global south. Going into COP28, we must ensure that climate justice is also on the forefront of our minds. Nature restoration targets should also involve helping those countries disproportionately affected by the climate crisis adapt to long-term climate-related changes. Scotland needs to engage in multifaceted response. This means climate mitigation, adaptation, and support to ensure that climate justice for all countries can be realized on our global path to net zero and nature restoration. Thank you, Deputy President.
Thank you, Mr. Chowdhury. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Ariane Burgess. Ms. Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I thank and congratulate my colleague, Mark Ruskell, on securing today's debate. Because as world leaders and others gather in Dubai at COP28, it is right that we, in Scotland's Parliament, take some time to talk about the twin crises of climate and nature and the all-encompassing work we need to do to create a livable planet for future generations, both here in Scotland and around the world. It is clear that the climate and nature crises share the same underlying cause. Our economic system that is based on extraction and exploitation of resources without regard for externalities, future consequences, or the deterioration of the commons. Because our climate and our natural resources are our commons. They also have intrinsic value and should not merely be considered important because of some commodified value that economic structures we create deem appropriate to give them. So today's debate is important to think carefully about how economic, social, and environmental justice are inextricably linked, and therefore how we as policymakers need to consider the links and connections across the often messy web of life. The northeast of Scotland, the region I'm privileged to represent, has benefited significantly from the Nature Restoration Fund, mostly in rural areas, as might be expected. I'd argue we need a wider view of what natures are worth supporting and restoring, and not be limited not to be limited by thinking that only some natures in some geographies matter. So I want to spend the rest of my time talking about a little spot in an urban environment that I think is worth championing, protecting and sustaining. The award-winning wetlands and reed beds in St Fiddoch's Community Park in Torrey. The brainchild of SEPA as a way of making space for biodiversity and supporting local people, these reed beds are relatively small in a relatively small urban green space in Torrey, surrounded by a community which is one of the most deprived in Scotland, with a life expectancy a decade lower than elsewhere in Aberdeen. Squished between industrial land and sewage works, a landfill site and incinerator, the park is the only accessible green space for this community. It is well loved and well used by people who live locally, mostly in tower blocks and flats. In stark contrast to the greyness of the heavy industry around them, the park and its wetlands and reed beds are vibrant, varied places with a range of habitats, species, facilities and amenities for all to enjoy. St Fiddoch's has what you might expect from a community park, but it also boasts areas of woodland, wet meadow, reed bed and diverse dry grasslands. And then there's the staggering biodiversity. Over 40 species of breeding birds, including 9 red list and 8 amber list species. Over 115 plant species, including a wonderful array of orchids. Hundreds of invertebrate species that are still, some of which, being documented. And otters, deer, and other mammals can be spotted in the reeds and woods. As autumn shifts into winter, we see migratory birds stopping over in the green spaces. Over winter, we'll see substantial snipe populations. All the work done a little over a decade ago by the Aberdeen Ranger Service and SEPA has really paid off. What was a polluted, poor quality and inaccessible area is now an award-winning biodiverse wetland. This nature too is worth protecting and restoring. We must not compromise already marginalised people's health and well-being and the restored nature they currently enjoy in the mistaken belief that these smaller natures don't matter as much as the grander natures others have already spoken about. It would be, I think, a travesty for the wetlands and reed beds and the wider park to be lost in the name of a so-called just transition. If this nature is lost, any transition will not be just. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. And I now call Ariane Burgess. Ms Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I speak in this chamber at a time when we are deep in a climate and nature emergency. That is the unavoidable backdrop to everything we do in this Parliament, but somehow it's not always foremost on the agenda. So I am grateful to my colleague Mark Ruskell for focusing our minds on it today. COP28 starts tomorrow, and there will be a renewed focus on how countries will meet their targets in the Paris Agreement to maintain a safe operating space for humanity and for the nature that supports us, that makes our lives possible. And that's why it is so important that we proceed with ambitious environmental policies like the proposals on clean green heating and warm green homes led by Green Minister Patrick Harvey. But despite Scotland leading the UK on decarbonisation of buildings, there is no way we can meet our climate targets without giving the same level of attention to nature. When our natural world is healthy and thriving, it's a key ally in our fight against climate change. But if humanity does not reverse rising emissions and nature loss soon, we will reach tipping points, setting off a cascade of global warming and species extinction that we can't undo. The good news is that we still have a small window of time, and we have people working tirelessly across Scotland to restore our depleted natural world, to raise us up the global biodiversity league tables from our current spot, 28th from the bottom, out of 240 countries. Seagrass restoration work on Loch Craignish is doing just that. It's led by the community with help from Sea Wilding, supported by the Nature Restoration Fund. Globally, seagrass captures carbon up to 35 times faster than tropical rainforests. So this project not only boosts biodiversity, but it also sequesters carbon and creates good green jobs. The Nature Restoration Fund, spearheaded by Green Minister Lorna Slater, is supporting several more projects in the Highlands and Islands this year. Protecting Gia's woodland project will remove invasive species and create a system of hedgerow corridors across the island. Scots Burns Farms in Invergordon will plant aspen trees to provide habitat for our precious capercaillie. And the Glencoe Habitat Recovery Project will restore woodlands, wetland and peatlands in Glencoe National Nature Reserve. Luing and Scarba host the Turning the Tide project, and in Badenoch and Stas Bay, there's work to restore five feisty species. Projects like these could go further and faster with multi-year funding, especially for non-invasive species, eradicating and prevention work to benefit seabirds and other island wildlife and to eradicate rhododendron from rainforest habitat. A great deal of the work on the ground to meet our climate targets will take place in the Highlands and Islands. The Highlands and Islands has the land and the nature that is pivotal in this national effort. So we need to welcome and accommodate more people in the region to deliver more and more projects like these. And that's why affordable rural housing is crucial. We need housing for workers and long-term homes to support stable, growing communities. We also need to continue increasing support for farmers to integrate trees on their farm, restore peatland, manage water quality, and create habitat mosaics. To conclude, finally, we must remember to keep our side of the bargain. Nature is powerful, but it can't stop climate change alone. We humans in Scotland must continue to play our part by reducing emissions, supported by policies that we can pass in this Parliament. Let's work with nature, not against it, to stop climate change and protect our shared home.
Thank you, Ms. Burgess. And I now call on Minister Lorna Slater to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to Mark Ruskell for bringing this debate and to all the members who've contributed today. It warms my heart so much to hear my colleague Maggie Chapman speak about how nature is our commons and that we should be celebrating the intrinsic value of nature. And so many of my colleagues in the chamber here today have done exactly that, celebrating specific species that they've enjoyed seeing, otters, specific projects that they've enjoyed seeing, specific champions of nature that they've been doing. Audrey Nicol saying she's the champion of the freshwater pearl. It's just wonderful to hear the commonality of treasuring nature and valuing it for its own sake, although we all acknowledge that restoration of nature can have benefits for us in terms of benefits for our communities and health, tackling this global health challenge, which is the consequence of our climate and nature emergencies, as well as sequestering the carbon that we know we need to do to keep global temperatures within a livable boundary. This is so much of a contrast to what Stephen Kerr was saying, calling golden eagles and beavers vermin. That is a real contrast to most people in the chamber who was valuing nature for its own sake. And I think that is a shame.
Please,
Stephen Kerr.
To be absolutely clear, I was quoting a Scottish farmer who was using his experience of what he's having to deal with in terms of running his business. That's who said that. Would the Minister not agree that we should be listening to Scotland's farmers when it comes to species like beavers and others that are causing their businesses and the landscape in which our food is grown damage?
Minister.
Absolutely, we need to be listening to farmers. I give him the specific example of Argatti, the site where they have received £65,000 of Nature Restoration Fund and had one of the first beaver sites in Scotland. And I have seen their posts on the internet and their challenge to other farmers to match them and meet their goals of thriving nature alongside thriving and profitable farm businesses. So many farms in Scotland are doing terrific things. I've met with the Nature Friendly Farming Network, with farmers doing organic farming, regenerative farming, and there is really good work here. Land managers who absolutely get that we can have thriving biodiversity alongside sustainable food production in Scotland. And this, we have huge opportunities ahead of us to bring all farmers along on this journey as we reform agriculture subsidies to ensure that farmers get paid to do the right thing, to produce sustainable food and to do the work to restore Scotland's biodiversity. I enjoyed very much the contributions of my fellow members when talking about the link between the nature emergency and the climate emergency. I'm so glad that the conversation has moved to a point where we are discussing these things together and how they interconnect, how increasing global temperatures increases the risks to our nature. More diseases, more pests, more invasive species, native species struggling to thrive in warming climates. Mark Ruskell highlighted the issues particularly around wild salmon and fish, which we know are so sensitive to temperatures, and of course declining fish numbers affect our seabirds. The statistics on our seabird decline, 50% decline in the seabirds, is absolutely devastating, sickening decline, and that is before the effects of avian flu have been taken into account. These are absolute emergencies in our nature space. And you know, things like the Nature Restoration Fund and all the work we're doing across Parliament on wildlife and Muirburn Bill, land reform, agriculture reform, the Natural Environment Bill, all of these things together to turn that tide from one of loss and decline and damage. And Mark Ruskell rightly pointed out that there has also been a 50% decline in flowering plants in Scotland, as illustrated by the latest publication of the Plant Atlas. That's really something to think about, that our parents and grandparents lived in a world that had more flowers in it, and therefore more insects, and therefore more birds. We live in a damaged and declined, decimated nature space. We talk about how beautiful nature in Scotland is, but how beautiful it used to be when there was just more of it. So working to stop that decline, to halt it by 2030, to substantially restore nature by 2045 is the goal of the Scottish Government, and the nature restoration projects highlighted today are part of that goal, of course. Faisal Chowdhury rightly mentioned our role as global citizens, and that he would like to consider that we should consider in our nature targets how we interact with the global community. And I would really be interested in hearing more on that, Faisal, as we go forward to developing our targets in the Natural Environment Bill. Of course, how we interact with the world as global citizens is important to tackling the climate and nature emergencies. Arianne Burgess highlighted the work that volunteers and workers do all over Scotland in restoring nature. And this is true whether it's tackling invasive species, trapping mink, whether it's farmers planting wildflowers down the sides of their fields. So many people in Scotland are spending their free time and their working time to restore nature in Scotland. And this is something that I absolutely celebrate. Arianne Burgess also highlighted that so much of our nature restoration funding is going to rural areas, to farmers, and to our coastal communities. This is creating jobs, and Arianne Burgess gave us a specific example on the Seagrass project of job creation. Also, I can give further examples, for example, the Cairngorm Connect project, our largest landscape scale restoration project, now employs more people on that nature restoration project than were previously employed when that land was under other management types, which is a direct contradiction to what Stephen Kerr is claiming, without any concrete examples brought, that jobs will be lost and the number of people reduced. Arianne Burgess is exactly right. We need more people in our rural areas, more people in highlands and islands to do this work. We've got peatlands to restore, we've got forests to plant, we've got wildflowers to plant, we've got rivers to re-meander, we have species to monitor, and we have farmers and rural communities to support. That's a lot of work, that's a lot of jobs, and I'm very proud of the work that the Nature Restoration Fund is doing for nature, jobs, rural and coastal communities in Scotland. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting until 2:30 p.m. Thank you.